Okay, so welcome to this Hyperledger Sweden meetup. My name is Roland and I'm happy to be your guest for today. And I think today we will have a really great session. And this session is, so that's me. And this session is about chaincode development environment. And this is a comparison between the Pinery and Docker version. So since the new version 2.2, we have the possibility to use the Pinery version of Ordera, Pia, and so on to make a development environment. And this is also described in the documentation, and but we can use also the old Docker version. And in this talk, I would like to give you an overview about this both approaches and a small comparison of the process. And then we can make a hands-on tutorial session where I can show you how you can use the Pinery version or the Docker version. And yeah, here you find our agenda in the slides. Later, I will post the slides on the Meetup page and on the LinkedIn page. And this session is recorded. You can also watch it later on the YouTube Hyperledger Meetup YouTube page. And here I have collected some links. So here's the link to the GitHub repository, the support material. I have copied this also in the chat. So when you would like to follow this, then you can look into this repository to see all the steps, what is needed to do this. And then here, two documentation links to Hyperledger Fabric documentation, official 2.2 and 2.3, Pia chaincode devmode. So it's interesting that in the 2.2 version, you will not find this documentation, this tutorial. And yeah, so it's new. Maybe it will come in the 2.2 version, I don't know. And then here I will find you will find a Medium article which I have written some weeks ago about this topic. Okay, so let's start with a short overview of these both approaches. And so in this session, we are going to talk about chaincode development. So in Fabric, we have the possibility to use chaincode, the smart contract, and this smart contract can be developed in different languages. And when we see this in a layer, when we order this in a layer, then we can say we have on top this chaincode development as an abstract position, and then we can use a Fabric contract, the so-called Fabric contract API. This is a new one in the 2.2 version, and it's a little bit different to the old shim version in the 1.4 version. And this is an abstraction layer, which gives you access to the ledger, and it provides an API. And with this API, you can interact with the ledger. So that's an important point to know, that you cannot connect directly to the ledger. So you have to use this user API. And in the 2.2 versions, they have a new version of this so-called contract API. And then the old version, there is this called shim. With this API, we can connect to this, but it doesn't matter. So this is something, we need something to connect to the ledger. And then we have different possibilities to do that. So the main language to do this is Go. And but you can do it also with Node.js or Java, and some other languages are in beta status. And maybe sometime we will have four or five different languages in which we can write our chain code. And they use then this contract API implemented in this language, and then we can connect to the ledger. And so this, and then we have two possibilities to connect to test, to write and test our chain code. So there is a so-called binary version. That means that you don't have to use the Docker versions, so you can work without Docker. And on the other side, you have the Docker version. So you can make a Docker network, a Docker compose file, and then you can create a dev network with one orderer and one peer, and then or with a CouchDB database, for example, and so on. So, and we have two approaches here. And when we compare these two approaches, the reason, well, let me first explain why is this so, why is this important? So the reason is that when you use a chain code in a Fabric network, then you have to, especially in the 2.2 version, you have to install it, you have to improve it, and when you have all improves collected, then you can commit to this chain code to the ledger or to the channel. And when you have a change to this chain code, then you have to upgrade, and in the upgrade process you have to do the same. So this has an that's a little bit that comes with a lot of effort. And to keep the way short, we have the possibility to use or to run the peer in a so-called dev mode. And that's the reason where we call this the dev mode, because we can start the peer in a special mode. And with this mode, we have to start and stop the chain code container or the chain code process by our own. And then we can get rid of this installation and upgrade process. So, and then it will be very easy to change your chain code, maybe in Go. Today we will see it in Go. And then you can build the chain code, and then you have to start the chain code container again, and you can test the chain code directly against the peer with a CLI command. And that's the reason why we need, from the developer perspective, a way to test, to do a fast test on our smart contract. And when we compare this, we see that in the binary version, we need a lot of terminal windows. So, So we can use SSH terminal windows for that, or we can use terminal multiplexer, for example, so that we have one SSH terminal to the machine. And then we have some panels inside of this TMUX terminal emulator. And for the binary version, we need four different terminals. And so these are some key facts I have collected to compare this both approaches. So in the binary version, we need one more terminal. And in the Docker edition, we need only three terminals. And so in the binary version, I have a point here, correct environment variables are important. So, and this is an important point to understand. When you use Docker and you start the Docker container, then this is an isolated room. So that means that when you use a pod, for example, then you could use the same pod on this Docker host again. And because it's isolated in the Docker container. But when you try this in a binary version, when you run now some peer, then you have to take care on this, because on this machine, can only be one pod used. And when you use it in double, then you will run in troubles. And the second part is that when you use the binary edition is to know where is your data stored. So, and this is a question where we take not so much effort in this, because when we use the Docker version, so we mount the Docker volume in the container. And then we have a data folder on the Docker host, for example, or we create the Docker volume. And in this Docker volume, we have our persistent data, this var Docker, var Hyperledger production folder. And then you will find it very easily because you have a Docker volume. And when you use the binary version, then it's stored the persistent, the chain code data, the blockchain data is stored on the same place, but on your local physical machine. So, and that's the reason why you have to know where is the data exactly stored in the Docker system or in the Fabric system. And then, so you will find it. And to get rid of this, we have to manipulate, we have to use the correct environment variables so that we can place the blockchain data and all other variables which we could need to create a binary development version, which will run on this machine. And one important point is that we have an official guide in the Hyperledger documentation, Hyperledger Fabric documentation. This is the link which I have shown you previously on the starting page. And for the Docker version, there is no official guide available. So, but I didn't found any information about this. So this is only my interpretation how this could work. And yeah, both versions basically do the same. And I think it's the choice of the developer, which version he or she would like to use. And when you compare this processes, then you see we have we need some terminals for this, as I have mentioned, and then the green ones are the binary versions, and the blue boxes here are the process of the Docker version. And you see that we can have so in terminal one, first is that we have to download the official Fabric repository. So, and this is a part which you need, and this is and this step is not needed when you use the Docker version. And then when you have this Fabric repository, then you have to build these binaries. So to build these binaries, you need this Go. This is all programs, peer orderer, config tx scan, and other tools are built in. Written in Go, and then we have to build Go binaries for that. And we have also, we need also some build tools to build these binaries. And that's a preparation step. And for the Docker composition, when we use this in the Docker version, the only thing what we have to do is we can start directly after we have installed the Fabric. We have followed the installing steps from the official documentation. And when we have installed Fabric samples and we have tried the test network, and then we are ready to go and can create this a second Docker composition where we can start the development network. So, and here we have yeah, so that's a little bit different in the approach. And then the steps are the same. So the first step is, the next steps are the same. So the next step is that we create a genesis block for this test network. This is a step which we have to do in both versions. And then we can start the orderer. In the binary version, we have to start the orderer. And for that, we need also a configuration, of course. And this configuration is a sample configuration, which is provided also in this Fabric repo repository. So this is I would show you a little bit later. And here we will find a ready configuration also with the crypto materials and certificates which we need. And this is called, this profile is called a sample devmode solo profile. And then we can start the orderer. And then the orderer starts in terminal one. So, and in the Docker composition, so we have in this Docker composition two services. One is the orderer service and one is the peer service. And when we start this, then we started with the same channel configuration. And then we have the orderer and the peer running in two Docker containers. And we have this all in the same window. So, and we don't have to start the peer in the terminal two. And that's the reason why we need one terminal less than in the binary version. So these are the steps until here. In terminal two, we have to start the Docker the peer, and we have to start the peer with a special option here, and this option is called peer chaincode dev. Chaincode dev, and when we start this in the terminal, then we can create. Then the terminal is also blocked. So, and then we have to create and join the channel in terminal three here. So we have to create the channel, and then we join the channel, and yeah. And in this terminal three, we can start and stop the chain code, yeah, manually. But in the first time when we start the chain code, we have to make all the steps to install, approve, and commit the chain code, but only for the first time. And this is the process for version 2.2. When you use version 1.4, then you will not have this chain code lifecycle policy. But the process is the same, but it's the same how you do it in the 1.4 version, but the process to install the chain code is a little bit different. And for the Docker version, we can in terminal two, we can create and join the channel, and then we can start and stop the chain code in this terminal as well. Yeah, so, and here I have this approve process. So we have to do this approve process only once. So for the first, for one time, and then we can use the CLI commands to use, so peer chain query and peer query and peer invoke to test our chain code here. And for the binary version, we need one terminal. So, and that's why because the terminal one is blocked through the orderer. So of course we can run this orderer in the background. So every process you on a Linux terminal, you can run it also in the background, but then we will not see the output from this process. And some in the development, it's important to see maybe the outputs from the chain code and from the orderer and from the peer. And that's the reason why the terminal is blocked through the process for the program, which runs in the foreground and not in the background. And yeah. So, and here you can see a guideline which steps you have to do when you use the binary version or the Docker version. So, okay, so, and when we try to do this, so I have here. So we can look also into this in this repo. This is the repo, and in this repo I have documented all the steps, so you can use this guide. And so we have two possibilities here. So we can do this binary edition or the Docker edition. So and let us start with the binary edition first. And yeah, so a little bit larger. So I start with a standard folder here. So this is a simple Ubuntu box, and there I have created the folder. I call it Fabric Dev. And in the Fabric folder here, we have the Fabric samples here. And that's basically, this follows the standard installation guide. So, and on the same level, I have created the Fabric Dev folder to run this. And the first step is that we have to clone this Fabric repo here. And when we have done this, then we have here a folder, it's called Fabric, and with all the files which we need. And here you see also this sample config folder, and in the sample config folder, we have all the configuration which we need to start the development environment, also for the binary version and also for the Docker version. We can use it also for the Docker version. And in this folder, I think two folders are important to know. One is this sample config. So, and you here, and here you see a config.txt YAML file. Of course, we need the channel, and this channel needs the configuration, and the configuration lives in this config.txt file. And then we need the core YAML file, and then here membership service provider folder with the crypto material for this test case, and then order YAML file as well. So, and this folder, this information we can use. And the second important folder is the build folder. And there's a bin folder inside, and there we will have a peer, an orderer, and then config.txt game file. So, but these three binary files will be created when you call the make command here. So, and this took some time, and and I have created this before. So, and that's the reason why I have here these three binary files. And with these binary files, yeah, so one question here in the chat. So when we follow official doc, we use binary approach. Yes. So in the official documentation, you have this binary approach. But when you think about this a little bit, so with this binary approach, you can do much more. So you can also say, okay, we create a network, a Docker composition network, and then we create on a second machine a peer. Which runs as a binary version. And you don't, maybe there is a use case where you say, okay, I don't want to run this in a Docker container or on a Docker host. And then I can use also this binary version to run a peer as on a single machine in a binary version. And then I can create maybe a Node.js application as a client application. And then I can query this client and make my queries. So for example, when you have a logging application or where you have to query a lot of data, or I don't know, And then you can, and you take must take care on performance, for example, then you can decide to create a network where you have the binary version. Maybe it's a little bit faster and you need less resources because of the fact that you don't need a Docker system for that. And then you can use also the binary version as well. But we also use Docker there. I don't know this. I don't understand this question. So you have to you have the choice. You can use both, and in the end, you have to decide which version is the best for you. In this presentation today, you will see both version, and then you can decide what is the best fit for yourself. Okay, but when we clone this repository, then we have to notice these two folders. So these two folders are important for us for this example here. So, and then, so we can leave this. So, and then I have created a simple structure. So I have created the folder with artifacts. So it's empty. Then I've created the chaincode folder with my chaincode. So this is the place where my chaincode, my Go files from the chaincode lives. So here the SA simple asset chaincode, we will use it later. So I have copied this from the Fabric samples and then we will use this. So here we need the place where we can put our chaincode and interact with it. And then we need, later I will create a data folder. And with this, in this data folder, the blockchain will be stored. So this is the place where we store the blockchain. And it's also empty for now. So, and so that's a simple structure. You can name it how you like. And yeah. So, and then we have this. So, and the first step is always put, we have to put this path here into the path so that we can call peer orderer and config tx scan. So, it's helpful when we use, we put this into the global path. And then we need, of course, this fabric config path environment. And this config path environment should be linked to the sample config folder here. So Fabric knows where is our configuration. And then we have the first step now is to use the config tx again tool to create the Genesis block. And and here you see this is the profile and we can look into this. So and you see here the configuration of this sample dev mode. So and there are other configurations. So you can look into this file. And so here you have the profile section and then you have here different configuration samples. So it's also useful from the administrator side to look into these configurations and see how you can use the different configurations. But from the developer side, we have here ready to use profile. And this is the configuration also with the proper endorsement policy here. So, but it's not important here because it's only for testing. So the only thing is that it works, that we can use the chain code with the CLI commands. So, but the important part is this profile is ready to use and that's why we use it here. And then we have to create a system channel and the genesis block, and yeah. The out and the place where we create this is our artifacts folder. Then we can use this. And then you see here the genesis block is created. And we should have here in the artifacts folder here one genesis block file. And yeah, so the next step is that we can start the hardware system. And we can use this in two ways. So we can export these three hardware environment variables, or we can use it also in a single command line. So for copy and paste, I use this single version, single command version. And so for a better understanding, so it's often better that we can use this export command, and then we have to see the single variables in a single way, so it's easier to understand. So and we need three of them. So we need the place where the genesis block lives, then we need the location from the file ledger, so that should be in our data folder and this data order folder, and then we need the genesis profile type, so that's the sample dev mode folder. And then we can start this. Now we will do it. So we use so we need different terminals. And here I have some helpful TMUX operations commands. And I will try it here with this. So and then we can start the hardware here. So and you see the hardware is running and the terminal is blocked. And now we need the new panel. So we can do this with Control B and quotes. And then we have splitted this terminal here in two. This is a little bit tricky. So it depends a little bit on the keyboard. So you have to practice this a little bit and then it works. So here you have helpful TMUX command, and there's also a cheat sheet page on the internet. And I've shown it several times here, and the link is in one of these meetup support materials also. And yeah, so hardware is running. So, and the next step here is that we have to start the beer. And for the beer, we need also some environment variables. So we need this core operation listen address, the file system path should be in onto the data folder. Then, okay, the logging is not so important, but we can do it. And then the chaincode listen address. And of course, the important command is here, beer node start. And then we have here the chaincode, beer chaincode dev. Is true. So, and when we copy this into the second terminal, we see that the beer is run. And then we have to split the window again, Control B. So, and then we have Control B and space. And then you can make the panels a little bit larger. So we have an ordering session. We have a panel where the peer is running. and then we have to create the channel. So, and for the channel, we have to create, we have to use the config.txgen file. And so I call the channel one, and in the artifacts folder, we will create this channel creation transaction. And we use also this predefined sample single membership service provider channel profile here. And the config path is also important, but we have set it in the terminal below. So we create the channel now. And so and here you have this channel transaction file. And then we can create the channel. And for the channel, we need the order address. So it's on the local host and the standard port. And then we have here the output block and the channel transaction file and the channel name, of course. So it works as well. And then we can join the channel. So, and you see, we have successfully submitted the proposal to join the channel. And the next step is to use our chain code and to start the chain code container here. And so we can go into the chain code folder. And we have here the, so I think we need now a new window. No, this one. So here you have this standard chain code. So this chain code is copy and paste from the Fabric samples. And the chain code does only set the value and get a value back. So it's like key value store. And yeah. And then we can build this chain code. But sometimes you don't have this vendor folder. So in this vendor folder, there are all dependencies from the chain code which we need, and we can install it with this command. So, and then we can build the chain code. So I will, no, it's not here. A simple chain code. So we remove the chain code. And then we build this chain code. So and you see here, that's our chain code. And then we have to start the chain code by ourselves. And This is done with this command here. And so here is the path to the chain to the chain code /simple-chaincode. And now the chain code is running. So, and we need one more terminal. Okay. So, and then we have to approve the chain code and commit the chain code. But this step we have to do only once. And these are the standard steps to install a chain code in the 2.2 version through this new lifecycle chain code environment policy or governance. And this is a command beer lifecycle chain code approve org. Then we can check this check commit readiness, and then we have to commit this. So we need to approve this from organization, from us sample org organization here. We have only one organization, and then we have to commit it. And the check for commit readiness is, we can do it, but we don't have to do it. We can skip this step as well. So the first step is that we approve this chain code. And you see it's valid. Then you can check if you are ready to commit your chain code with this command. And you see here, which organizations has approved this chain code. And we say only sample org is true, but we only have this organization. And then we can commit it. So. So, and now the chain code is ready. And we have here a valid transaction. And then we can test it. So, with the peer chain code invoke command, we can call this my chain code. So, because we called it here, my chain code. So, that's the chain code name. And then here we have the C option for the command. And when we can use this init function here to create them, then we have chain code invoke successful. You see here the committed block. And then you can query this. So. And you have here hello. So, and we see, and then you can see here what about the chain code. And we can test the second one. Then you have here the block committed, and then you get message to, you see hello to here. So, okay, so, and this is how this works. So, but what happened when you change this chain code? So then you have, stop the chain code itself. So, and we can do this when we switch back in this panel, Control B Q, and you see the numbers, Control B Q, you see the numbers here. And with two, you switch into this panel here. And then you can Control C, and then you stop this. And now we can modify. So I have here prepared some debug value. So maybe we will put this here. So we have chain code. We have the import for the OS. So, okay. So now we have added the debug value, but only the asset name, the queried asset name should only be displayed when we deliver the special environment variable dev mode enabled, for example, when it's not is not equal to zero here. And so, but the important point here is that we change the chain code now. And now we want to test if this works here. So, and how we can do this. And yeah, we are in the in our chain code panel here. And the step is that we have to build the chain code again. So we can build this chain code again. And then we can start it. And we can start the chain code with the same command. And we have here the enable test mode. So we have here in this single line command also the environment variables. And we want that only when this devmode enabled environment variable is delivered to this chain code. And it has a random value. I set the value test. Then the key should be printed. So, and then we start the chain code again. And now we switch back with control P Q and then the number, control P, the number of the terminal. So, and then you can make your query again. So query two, and you see here, the asset is asset two, is the MSG two. And one, no, this one is this one. And yeah, that's it. And now you can make, oops, and then we can stop this chain code again. Like this again. So, and then we can build the chain code again. We can start it. Control B3. And you see your changes. And this is the way how you can use the peer dev mode in the binary version here. And the same we can do also with the Docker version. So, but for this we have to close this. So, okay. And yeah, okay. So, and for the Docker mode, so do we have any questions here? Where can I get this MD files? Yes. That's cool. Thank you. Looks really cool. Yes, it is. You have to get familiar with the keys. And I think for me, the difficultest part of Max is how you can scroll inside of a panel. So that's the reason why I have this here. So control P and then on the Mac tastature the function and the up or down keys. And then you come in a scroll mode. I think it's a scroll mode. And you can scroll up and down. And yeah, to leave this mode, you have to use the escape key. So this works on a Mac keyboard. So I don't know how is this on the Windows or on the other keyboards. Is there any way to get the chain code? Do you mean this chain code? Yeah, this is official chain code. When we look here, you can find a lot of chain code examples in the, when you install the Fabric samples. And here in the Fabric samples, you have here a folder chain code, and this is the folder which I have copied. And but you find here the marbles example, the marbles in private with private data collections examples. You find here the fab car, and in some folders you find this is an external version. So in Fabric 2.2, there is the possibility to use the chain code as an external service. This is an example. Then in some chain code folders here, you find the Go version, a Java version, JavaScript version, TypeScript version, but not every example has all languages implemented. So this marbles example has only the Go chain code here. And you see here the meta-inf file, meta-inf folder. And that means that the CouchDB is involved because we have here the index owner JSON file. This is needed when you want to use CouchDB instead of LevelDB. Yeah, so and here you find a lot of chain codes here, but you find it also here in this asset basic transfer. So here you find this is a standard chain code and application code folder where you can find the proper chain code for this standard demonstration chain code here. Also with tests, with Go tests here. Yeah. And then you find also here, this is the chain code. Yeah. And you have it in Java, in JavaScript and so on. And you have here also the in the application folder, and then the application folder, you find here the JavaScript or better Node.js version of the for the client, from the client side. And this is needed to connect to use the chain code without the CLI commands. So CLI command is only for testing and for the administrator part, and the JavaScript client, the Node.js client, I think it's the standard language for the client side. And here you find how you can interact with an app.js. So this is the an Express.js version. I know this is, oh no, this is also a CLI version. But you here find all the commands you need to submit a transaction. And here evaluate to query a transaction, and you find here samples. So, and here you find all the chain code. Difference between asset transfer basic and chain code folder. I think these folders are new, so you will not find this in the 1.4 version. So. And in the 1.4 version, only the chain code folder here. And this is, and oh, I think a large difference is that here is you, this the application, the chain code. So maybe from the Go side, here you can see the contract API. So with the 2.2 version, you should use the contract API. As an API to connect with the ledger, and in 1.4 there wasn't this contract API. So this is a new version of this level of abstraction, and I think maybe that's the reason why they have this put this here on the side and on this first level. So maybe that all people see that this is new. And yeah, and then the chain code here, the chain code folder. These are examples. These examples exist also in 1.4 version. So, and when we look at the SAC here, then you have here the shim implementation. And that's, I think, maybe that's, I don't know, I don't know why this fabric sample structure is like it is. And I think this is because this is the old version. So all this APAC is also an interesting example because this is, in this example, it's also based on the shim, scheme. And this is an asset attribute chain code example, I think so. So in this example, attribute based access control, this is the right term. So this is an example for an attribute based access control chain code. And with this, you can, when you make a transaction, then you have to use a certificate from a user, and this user can have some properties. And with the chain code, you can read these properties with this here. And then you can say, okay, when this certificate has the property, maybe a group or department development, then you can write in the chain code, you can use the write function or the store function, the put function, for example. And when you a user which belongs to the marketing, for example, then your certificate has the attribute marketing or something like that. And then when this user tried to use this function, then you will receive an error, for example. So this is for permissions. So, and this is an example, and this is attribute based access control. This is also based in the started in the 1.4 version, and is also based on this shim here. Yeah, so I don't want to go too deep now in the chain code development. So this is, so for this, we should make a session directly on chain code development. So I show you the examples here, but I don't want to go too deep into the chain code development because this session should be around the installation and configuration of the chain for the development environment. So, and this stub and this shim here, if you're confusing. So this is standard Go language. So, and so you have to look into the Go documentation to understand what the first parameter and the second parameter here means. So, and yeah, but you find here other examples as well. So the commercial paper is also a good example where you find helpful tools. For example, one important point is here, the under organizations application. So here the add to wallet script here. And this is very helpful here. So we need when you use this Node.js application and then you connect to the Fabric network, then you need the user and this user profile or this user credentials, this identity is stored in a wallet. And then you have to enroll and create a new user. But this is only possible when you have an Fabric Sway running. And in this development environment, we don't have an Fabric CA running so that we can register and enroll a new user for a demo application or for something like that. And when we create with the crypto material for every organization, two users are in the default way created. And I have to drop off, but thanks for the bye. And in the default configuration, two users are created, an admin user and the user one. And with this script with the source code here in this script. So I think you can use it, but you have to change the paths here. Then you can convert the user one to a wallet identity, which you can use in for your Node.js application. And that's a helpful CLI tool to convert an existing identity to the wallet in your for your client application. So, and it makes sense to look through these examples here, and you see here a lot of examples where you can learn to do different things here from the shell scripting side, from the chain code side, from the Go side, Java side, and so on. So a lot of best practice examples here, and you can find and you can look what is a good solution for yourself. Okay, so yeah, this is a short side note on the different chain codes here. So you can copy all these chain codes, all my examples, mostly from this official documentations here from the Fabric samples here. Okay, so now let's move forward and go to the second example. And this is the example with the Docker version. So, and for this, we need a Docker composition. And I have prepared here in the Fabric samples. So, and I've created here a folder. I called it Dev Network. And in this folder, so let's jump here. So, and we have basically the same structure. We have an artifacts folder with a chain code folder with the simple as a chain code example here. We have a folder with ledger data. So, and then we have here the sample configuration. This is the same sample configuration we have used before. So I have copied in here this into this in this folder. And then we have a Docker composition. Here with an orderer and a BR. So, and we need this env file. Don't forget this env environment file. So this .env file, these are environment files for the Docker composition. And yeah, so it's basically a little bit copy and paste from the test network, from the official test network. And yeah, the only thing what we have to change here is that we take care on this compose project name. So that should be the same like the folder. So dev network here, because I called my folder dev network. Yeah, so, and we need this Docker composition. So with one orderer and one peer. And you see here the same environment variables. So basically the process is the same and we need the same elements, but the configuration is a little bit different. So when you are more familiar with Docker, then you are fine if you use the Docker version. And when you are not so familiar with Docker, when you do it a little bit more with the binary versions or work with the binary versions, then you can do the other way. So, and important here is what is important. So, okay, here, I mean, for the order configuration, we need the sample config membership service provider folder. Then we need the Genesis block and we need the place where the orderer puts his data, his ledger data, and we mount this into the container here. So, and that is what I have meant before. When you use the Docker version, you don't, sometimes you don't recognize where all this data lives because you mount a folder to a path. So this is a copy and paste action sometimes. And yeah, and it works all the time as long as you use the Docker composition. And but when you switch to a binary version, then this path is on your local machine. So, and also this path is on your local machine. So, and that's important to know that you have, then when you use the binary version, a persistent version, and the files are stored on this location here. And yeah. Yeah, and for the peer, the same here. Yeah, so the gossip, for example, gossip bootstrap, we don't need this because we only have one peer here. And the volume here also here, only the ledger data. So you see here, we mount this on var Hyperledger production. So, and then here the command, important, you see, peer chaincode dev is true. Okay, so that is this, and yeah, and then the sample config, so is, yeah, here we can look into this, that's the same I have shown before. Important here are the profiles. Yeah, and you see here, and that's also a good place to learn how you can set up your profiles in different configurations. See, here you see old Kafka configuration. So because Kafka is deprecated in 2.2, so we should all should use Raft here, yeah, also here, and so on. So there are a lot of different configurations. The core YAML file, that's an interesting part. And because have you ever asked yourself, where all the environment variables came from? And which environment variables are available? And all environment variables came from the orderer YAML file, from the core YAML file here, and for the orderer from this orderer YAML file. So when we look into the core beer listen address, so, then this is the environment variable here. So, yeah. And this is, so look at this. And when you try to address this address here, then, yeah, you mean then this is your variable name. So you have, and this is the prefix. You can say it's a prefix. Yeah. So this said all variables, all values here in the, from the beer section, yeah, have the prefix core beer. And then listen address, network ID, chain code address, for example, here. And so on. So you can address all this configuration values with the environment variables here with the same schema. So, and for the orderer is it the same, but the orderer use orderer general here. And you can find also all orderer environment configuration variables here into this. Listen address, listen address, listen port. Yeah. So, and so, so we can change this genesis mode. Or not. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Fantas. Okay. I thought this is, it is in this file. Okay. Maybe I'm wrong, but yeah, but for the environment variables of the core of the peer, you will find all these environment variables here. But also for the orderer, okay, I have to look later. Okay, so, and yeah, and the steps are here. So we don't have to, the only thing is what we have to do is we create a folder with this small subfolders. We have to create, we have to copy this sample config and the environment and this env file. And then we can copy also the Docker composition from the test network. So, and then we can modify this. Blah, blah, blah. So this you have seen, Docker network. This is the same name. And then customize the Docker compose file. So we have to, we need only the orderer and the peer here. And we have to change the orderer endpoints here. Okay, so. And and that's it. And then we can create the artifacts. So we have to set the environment variables for this new. And so let's check if this is empty. Yes, so, and this, the creation of the Genesis block is the same as we have seen before. We have a Genesis block here. Then we can create the channel transaction. In the same way. And then we can start a network with Docker Compose up. So, and now both the orderer and the peer are running. And then we can switch to the control B Q1 to the second terminal. And so we have to switch to fabric samples dev network here. And we have to set the config path. And then the next step is the creation of the channel. This is also the same step as in the binary version. Yeah. So receive block null, block zero, and then we can join. So, okay, and then we can switch into our chaincode folder. And here we have this simple asset chaincode. Yeah. And that's the same here. So, and so, and you see here, you have here a lot of the folders here, not the chain code, but we can look at later. So, and as simple as a chain code. So, okay, so that's the same chain code without our modification in the get function here. And yeah, we try to do the same here now. And then, I have here already installed the vendor. So the vendor are the dependencies for this chain code. So, and you can see also, if you look tree vendor, and you see here. So, and now let us scroll a little bit, Control B, F, and key up. Ha! It works. And you see here on the right side, I think now you're in the scroll mode, then you can scroll up in this terminal, and with the key down, you can scroll down. With the escape, we can skip this mode, because we cannot scroll here with the mouse pointer. Yeah. And maybe that's a little bit from the practical aspect and disadvantage. We can use here for SSH terminals, and then we have a little bit more comfort in the case of scrolling. But the good thing of the TMUX terminal is we can leave our terminal and without stopping the system. So we can detach from this TMUX session, and then we can log out from the terminal. And tomorrow we can come back, and then we can reattach to this session, and all is running. And that's the good thing of a terminal multiplexer. So you can have this configuration running, and you can stop your SSH connection to the server. And tomorrow you can come back, and then you can start with your work until, and all is running. So, and that's, I will show you this then in a second, how this works. And that's really the cool thing, because when you use the terminal and you have this running in terminals, then when your terminal session ends, also your, that means that your process ends, and then your system is down, because the session is closed, and also your process is closed. And that's the really cool thing, that you can have this configuration in the background running, and then you can attach and reattach, detach and attach to the to this session. Okay, so let us quick build this chain code. So okay, now we have built this chain code. And then we can start it in the same way. Oops. Small typo. SAC. Okay. So now the chain code is running, and then we move to the next terminal. So we can control B and control B X, then we kill this panel. So control B cool two. So now we are okay. So and now we have to do the same approve process. But we have to search for examples, dev network. So set the config path variable. So, and then we have to approve this chain code. and you can check the awareness. And then we can commit the chaincode. And now the chaincode should be valid and ready. And then we can do the same. So test our chaincode. Let us test. And we have chaincode successfully. And then we query the chaincode. Roland. So. You can create a new version of this value. Roll into. And yeah, and then when we change this chain code, so we do the same, Control-B-Q-1, and then we Control-C, and we can close this. And then we can make the same modification here. So I will do it only once. So we need this OS package imported. So it's here. And yeah, and then we only have to do is to build the chain code and to start the chain code. So, and then we can start it. Control-B-Q-2, and then yeah, nothing happened because we did not use the devmode environment variable. So there is no output, no print here. Control-B-Q-1. So we stopped it. We stop it, and then we can use this environment variable. No such file. We are the force. Yeah, so Q2 and you see SS1. And now you can change your chain code very easily. And also in a quick way. I changed something. I built it new. And then I started the chain code. I switched to the second terminal. And now I have tested it, and you see here, this is my change. This was my change. Okay, so, and then I say, okay, I'm fine for today. And now I have to leave. And now we can say Control-PD, and now we have detached us from the session. And now we can close this terminal. And that's it. But in the background, the development environment is still running. And we can look at Chmux LS. We can see, okay, we have here one terminal, one window running. So you can have different terminals in the background run. So, yeah. And then you can detach to this Chmux attach option. T and then the name dev. And here we go. And I think that's the most advantage which you can have with some terminal multiplexer when you use this dev environment. So, and somewhere to my, to all this stuff here, to this environment here. So my environment here, this is an Ubuntu box, which is running on DigitalOcean, and the blockchain is also running on DigitalOcean. And on my local machine, I only use a Visual Studio Code Editor, and I use the SSH Fabric extension, SSH extension, and I connect, and I can connect directly to my virtual machine on, in the cloud, and I can work here as I would work on my local machine, but I don't have to install anything on my machine here. And I think that's a really cool developer environment. So, and we don't, so you can do it also on Windows as well. So when you work on Windows, you can also use Visual Studio Code with the SSH extension, but you can use the Linux environment and you don't have problems with file names and file paths and something like that. And I think that's a pretty cool environment here. So, okay, of course, and you can hear different versions of chaincode. So the system is the same. So when we say we have a ledger and then we have a channel, and on this channel, we can install different chaincodes. So you can have, you can test also a second chaincode in this configuration to the same time, because we can install on the channel different chaincodes. And yeah, so it depends on you and on your fantasy, how you can organize your development environment here. Okay, so is there something interested here? Okay, no. Yeah, so I think I'm now on my end. And yeah, so today you have seen two possible approaches how you can easily test your chain code. You can use the binary version. To this version, you will find your official you will find official documentation here in this link. I'll look back here. So running chaincode in dev development mode. Yeah. So, and look here, this is the release 2.3. So when we look at the stable version 2.2, we don't have this here. Yeah. Don't ask me why, I don't know. And yeah, and the Docker version is not documented. And that's the reason why I have created this GitHub repo here. Here, the Docker dev mode. And here you find all the steps which we have seen today. Yeah, so I think we are done with the overview and the presentation. Yeah, do you have any questions? Are there any questions in the chat? Oh, thank you. So it is a better solution for low RAM machines. So it is a better solution for low RAM machines which have lost of storage to use the terminal at all. Hmm. Yeah, no. Ah, doesn't, no, no. TMUX terminal also run after shutdown system. That is, I don't think so, but this is a question I have tackled a while, but I found some scripts but I think that will not work. So when you restart the machine, I don't want to say it will not work. So some cool guy has found, I'm sure some cool guy has found a solution for this, but normally the tmux session is lost when you restart your machine. So you have to make a script, and I think I can remember, I saw a script, but I haven't used it, that you can store this tmux session when the server is shut down. And when you restart it, then you can restart reassemble or reset your tmux configuration for these sessions. So that's the only disadvantage. And the scrolling is for me a problem. So, but when you are familiar with the terminal, with the keyboard, then I think this is a good choice to store, to use it. There are other questions. So it is better, so now, Truxton also now, should we all connect on WhatsApp group to share our doubts and errors and learning, share our connect? We have already a Slack channel, and you can, I think I could, if you want, I could post the invitation link here in this chat. And in this Slack room, in this Slack channel, you can ask your questions. But I have to say, at this time, there is no much, there is not so much traffic in the Slack channel. So, but yeah. So, but we don't need the WhatsApp group, so we can use the Slack channel for this. We will come. Clone someone's favorite project. Then you can do some more steps. If you clone someone's favorite project, I don't understand this question. Have to drop off buttons. We have to get to this instruction file. So I missed it earlier. So okay. See you in the chat. Long the current docker. Oh, Antonia has left the room. Okay, so please share the link. So one moment. I have to find it. I hope this is the right one. Okay, so any other question? Please have a session on end-to-end basic application. So do you mean a session how you can write the Node.js application to connect to the ledger? Yes, so in this we can do this, so yes, so I will see. So for the next session, I have planned, maybe that would be a good idea. So for the next session, I have planned a comparison between, it's about the keys. So when we query something, when we store something in the blockchain, then we need the key, so, and the value. That's all. So to store anything in Fabric, we need the key and the value. So the value, the key is a string, and the value is set by is binary data. And binary data is an object, it's an array, whatever is. And then, but we can use, when we use this key, then we can query asset into the blockchain. But the key is a string. So it depends on the used state database. So when we use LevelDB as a database, as a state database, then we can only query the key or a composite key or a key range. So, and the interesting part is the composite key. And we cannot make in the LevelDB a rich query or to query a property from the asset, for example. So when we need, when we have a use case where we have to query, when you look at the car example or the fab car example, there you have colors, for example, a property, it's called color, and you want all red cars, to query all red cars, then you cannot do this with the LevelDB. So you have to do CouchDB. And when you use CouchDB, then you can make rich queries and all, and you can do all the queries which CouchDB has. So you can use aggregation functions, you can use whatever, every query you can do in CouchDB. And maybe in the next session, I would like to show how this fits together and how we can use a composite key to query some data. Because I used this composite key in a project last week. And then I was thinking, okay, this is a good example to use the prototype, the composite key. And then I observed that we cannot query a partial part of the composite key. So you have to use always the prefix from this composite key. So you can, that means that you cannot query when you have a composite key, which is established with three parts, then you cannot query only the last part of this composite key. So you have to query the whole key. So you can only query part one. Yeah? You can query part one and two, and then and one and part one, two and three. So you only, and you cannot query the part three alone. So for example, and that was impact. No, I don't know, impact, no. So this was that was really new to me. And this, I think this is a good example how you can to explain how things are stored in Fabric and how we can query this. And we don't store keys in Databricks, right? We don't store keys. When you mean with keys, credential keys or certificates, yes. So in the database, you don't store, but that's not true. So you can store the keys also in the database. Yeah, they are there is, I think this, the example for this is also in the Fabric examples. And this example is the, I think, commercial example. And we can use, I'm wrong, not the key. So part keys. So when we use the client application, we need a local wallet. And in this local wallet, we need the private key and some credentials from the user. And these keys we can store in a database. So, and we can store it also in the memory because we can use different wallets. So we can use a wallet for the file wallet, yeah, in the folder. We can use a wallet in the memory. And with this in the memory, we can use also a wallet in a MySQL database, for example, or in a Postgres database. So, and this example is with a Postgres database. I think I saw this on the official IBM site or in the commercial paper site. So, but it's a difficult questions, but when you mean you want to store your keys, your certificates, and, then you don't, I think it's not a good idea to store keys in a database. So Fabric so has this hardware key storage, HSM, hardware storage module extension, I think. So you need a secure place where you can store your certificates. And with keys, you mean the certificates. Okay, so I think now we are on the end. Thanks for attending this session. Later, you will find also the recording, and I will put the slides also on the meetup, in this meetup, on the meetup page, in this meetup forum, so that you can receive this. Okay, then thanks for attending this session, and have a good day, night, or whatever.